Hello. Welcome to my art studio. So I don't normally do Facebook Lives, but I thought that I would give it a try and let you join me as I paint live. And since I don't normally do this, bear with me if I struggle with answering questions or comments that might be on the camera. Doing the best I can. But today, right now, I thought I would go ahead and work a little bit more on this particular portrait. If you've been following me, you may know that I've been working on quite a few. I'm just going to show you three of them today that I'm currently in the process of working on. This one right here is quite a large one. It's 30 by 40. It's in this stage of the game, which is still very early. Well, I really shouldn't say that. It's not finished, but all the bones are laid out, and so it's just a matter of putting the meat on the bones and all the details that come. But I work in processes of lots of layers. So all three of the paintings that I've been working on, this is the other one, are at the same stage. And that way I, you know, if I can work multiples and put those layers down as a base layer, get the whole foundation correct, and then I can move on to all the details and the fun stuff. If you follow me, you know that most of what I do are pet portraits. That was not how I started out. I'll tell you just a little bit about how I got to that point, in case you're interested. many moons ago, I started out as what was called back in the day a graphic artist. But it's not the same as what a graphic artist is today. So I actually used to hand draw for the Yellow Pages, and I worked for a sign company, and everything was hand drawn and hand painted. And then of course I did commissions as well. So people were always my favorite to do. So I did a lot of people portraits, and people would commission me to do their pets and stuff like that. But most of what I did was hand-drawn, not even painted. It was, I did a lot of charcoals back in the day. Anyway, fast forward just a few years and the computer age took over, and I could no longer call myself a graphic artist because I didn't know the computer programs. I didn't understand all that. I went into a stage of you didn't really have to be an artist. You just had to know how to do graphics on the computer. And so that kind of made what I did die. The whole hand done things was kind of, I couldn't keep up with that. Anyway, wasn't a bad thing. It forced me into thinking differently. And so I started doing murals. I started doing custom murals for commercial businesses as well as for residential, which kind of went along with the signs. They were still hand painted. So I moved on to that. And then the early 2000s, I got into doing furniture painting and things such as that, but I always kept my commissions going, and I still always had pet portraits, and people would ask me to do a painting to match their living room or something like that. So I was always doing stuff like that. Anyway, as the years progressed, a few years ago, I learned about a major company that contracted pet portrait artists. And so I submitted my work, and the rest is history. I started getting pet portraits through them, and then it kind of became my niche and kind of grew from there. So that's why I do a lot of pet portraits. But I do a lot of other things because for me, my mind is constantly in this creative mode. So I'm looking for things all the time. Well, actually, I think about things all the time. I never run out of ideas. I get gridlocked into too many ideas and it's like, I don't have enough time to do it all. But anyway, so my focus today is going to be on pet portraits. So I'm going to be working on this one right here. If you do have any questions for me, please feel free to ask them. I have a box down below. And I see that some of my old friends are joining me from the gallery, Art on the Square, a wonderful gallery in Somerville, South Carolina. I used to be in that gallery, and there's some fantastic artists in there. So if you get a chance to go by there, they're with me here today. So, but right now we're going to be working on this dog. I'm going to start with the eyes because for me, the eyes are the most important thing. If I can get the eyes right, then the rest of the animal just comes to life. And that really has the personality in it, the eyes. So if I can get the eyes correct. And what's interesting about this dog is there's one blue and then there's one like an amber brown. So that is something very unique. I've already laid out the base. I did the background. Here's my reference photo, if you can see it over here. I printed out quite large. So when people do commission me to do a pet portrait, it's very important that they give me a clear photo. The clearer, the better. The eyes in particular, so that I can capture that. But I can work with photos that are not quite so clear. The company that I do, that I'm contracted with, they send me the worst photos ever. And so I do a lot of photo editing because now I do understand computer graphics and things like that. But back in the day, anyway, so I can edit the photos and give them as clear as possible. But the portrait's only going to be as good as what the photo can be. So I can only imagine some of the details that are in there. So if you do hire me or book me for a commission, just remember that. So first I'm going to go in, and as you can see, I've already got, I think I'm going to be a superhero without these, but I need these for the details. I lay out a foundation, an underpainting in a solid form of ink. It's made by the company Derwent, and it was actually created for the purpose of painting on fabric. And I discovered them a few years ago and just loved the fact that I could go ahead and lay my painting out and draw all my details and find all my colors and find all of my shades, be able to locate everything so that I can give it good dimension. I already dropped my brush. And so I pre-draw everything out, not with every painting, but with things that are photorealistic, because I want to make sure that it looks exactly right. I do a lot of measuring. I do very detailed drawing in advance, because the foundation of the painting to me is the most important step. And if I don't get that right, then the painting can't proceed. So I lay the foundation out and I use these inks that are in a solid form. You just add water to them. And That's what all of this is. Now, the background I've already painted out, but this part is all done in these inks. And now I can go in and I can actually paint on top of it, and I use acrylics. I use a long drying, or I should say slow drying acrylic made by the company Golden. Golden Artist Colors. They are my favorite when it comes to doing my portraits. And they work really well with these inks. And I'm one that likes to paint in light layers rather than in heavy layers. I like to take it slow and get all the details. Get everything right the first time, rather than lay something on too heavy and then have to start over. So I'm just laying in it's actually a translucent black that I'm using, just to get the darkest areas. And get the eyes first. Now I'm gonna pick up some of my blue, and I'm adding some white. Just like so. Hope you can see that. I don't know how much detail that you can see from the distance. Pick up just a little bit of gray too, because there's gray in this area over here. And again, I'm doing light layers first. Can always build on the layers, and that actually adds more depth. This painting is actually for a woman in Nova Scotia. It's my first time sending one overseas. Well, I don't know if you consider it overseas, but out of the country. So this painting actually has to go through customs. So we'll see how that goes. It's a gift from her aunt and uncle who live here in the States. And they actually hired me to paint their cat a couple months back. I did a portrait of their cat, and afterwards they asked if I would do this portrait as a gift for their niece. The dog's name is Fernie. A tiny bit of blue in the light of the eyes that's reflected. I imagine because of the sky, because this dog was photographed outside. I always want to capture Hi, Melanie. Melanie is my neighbor. But we didn't meet because we were neighbors. Ironically, we met because she told me she had been following me on Facebook, wanting to have a portrait done of her dog one day. And so she contacted me when she was ready, and I did a portrait. And afterwards, and she had told me she resided in Somerville, which is where I live. And so I completed the portrait, and then I asked her if she wanted to meet somewhere for me to deliver it to her, or if she wanted to come to my home, or if she wanted me to bring it to her house. And she's like, oh, well, I live, and told me, I'm not gonna say, told me the neighborhood she lived in, and I was like, well, me too. Turned out we live across the street from one another, just a couple houses down. And that's how we actually ended up meeting. And she is an awesome person. She's just really sweet, just caring, and yeah. And she and my one other neighbor, Amy, helped me put my mind at ease while my husband was going through his health issue, because she is a PA. And so she and my neighbor Amy, who is a nurse, let me know that if anything went wrong, they were right here for me. So, you know, Melanie, I really love you for that. You're extra special. Yeah, hopefully you can see that well enough to know that his blue eye is there. Let's let this dry for a little bit, and I'm going to move on to this golden amber shade of eye. Deepest part of the black first. Interestingly, you know, black is not just black. Now, this color, I told you I'm using a translucent black, but I also have an opaque black that I use. But in the fur of this dog, there's a lot of blue and a lot of gray, and whether you can tell it or not, that's the shade of inks that I used to lay it out. The only places that are really black are those deepest, darkest spots, like the nose holes and around the eyes. But most of what you see is actually navy blue, some purple. And I love, you know, finding those colors in the fur in particular. White dogs are really fun to do because there's a lot of pink and peach in the white ones. A lot of purple, pink, peach, yellow. And there's white on this dog too. So figured I'd take a moment to kind of update you all on what's going on in my life with the art world. I was in the Charleston Artist Guild Gallery, but I recently moved out of it in February 1st. That was my last day there. I loved being there, so that wasn't the problem. Actually, there was really no problem. It's just that if I know that most of you know, when my husband had his heart transplant last year, it kind of changed some things in our lives. That was a biggie. And so I had to make some decisions as to what the best way to use my time and money was going to be. And for quite a while, this has been our primary source of income, has been my art. And though I make money working from the gallery, the time that I had to put in for working down at the gallery, I just couldn't do that right now at this point in time in my life. I needed to prioritize, and I make more working from home in my studio online than I do in an actual gallery right now. It would be different if the gallery was, represented me, in that they had a working staff that they paid to sell my work. But when I have to go down and actually man the gallery as well, it takes time away from my time in the studio, and that's where I had to make the decision. So I'm not opposed to being in a gallery again. I just can't work at the gallery too. So I do have some events that are coming up though. In July, I will be the featured artist down at Jekyll Island at the resort. The Goodyear Cottage Gallery has invited me to display my work, and I will be the only fine artist, visual artist, that will be there for the month of July. There will be a reception, an artist reception, the first Sunday of July. I can't remember the dates exactly, so I will have that on my website. If you haven't followed me on my website, you can see the upcoming events there. There'll supposed to also be a sculpture artist, a 3D artist, who will be in the gallery with me, but it'll just be the two of us. It'll be at the gallery for that month. So I'm excited about that. I was also invited next month for the Charleston Artist Guild monthly meeting that will be held at the Charleston County Public Library down on Calhoun Street to be the speaker. And I'll be doing a live painting demonstration there. And that is open to the public, so if anyone wants to come. The date will be posted on my website as well, and I'm sure
since you follow me on social media or you found me on social media, that I'll be sharing that. Those details. Wow, I like the way that looks. Now again, there's that highlight that's right there. And that highlight is actually a very soft blue because of the sky. That's what's being reflected. Pick that up just a little bit. I also have some other events that will be coming up, but they're to be decided. I am waiting yet to hear, so I may be down at the North Charleston Arts Festival just for the block party. So I may be down there doing a paint demonstration.
Oh, hi, Sharon. Picking up just a little bit of gray right in here. Piece right here. Using a shade of green that I absolutely love, and I use it for so many things in my paintings, but it's made by Golden, and it's just such a beautiful shade. And believe it or not, there's green in this. Remember I told you black has so many shades in it, but the highlight is green. Makes that highlight pop instead of doing white where that highlight is. A tiny tiny shade of green. Same thing right here where I put the gray. Just gonna add just a hair to that. Perfect.
Now, a lot of people ask me if I paint in oils, and I do. I do paint in oils.
I love oils. I absolutely love oils. They're like butter. They're so easy to paint with. Everything blends together, and if you make a mistake, you can wipe it away because it dries so slowly. But with my pet portraits, most of the time I paint in this water-based medium, using the inks and the washes and the acrylics for a couple reasons. One, the fumes are like none and it's easy to clean up. Although I will say with oils, it's pretty easy too, because you don't have to wash your brushes every single time if you just keep them very oily. You can wipe them out and then just oil them. But with this, I can just use water and clean my brushes up. And because I'm doing for, especially when I'm doing for the company that I contract with, they need so many in such a short period of time, I need to be able to get them out quickly. So I don't have to worry about drying time. With oils, they, after they're painted, you still have to wait a time to make sure that they get that finishing varnish on top of them. And you really technically are supposed to wait 6 months before you actually do that step, but there's some drying agents that you can use in order to speed that process up. But it's a much slower process that way. And the fumes do kind of get to me. Although I like to use safer type of oil mediums, like I use lavender oil, lavender spike oil, lavender oil, and those are much better. In fact, my husband likes the way they smell. And my art studio is a bedroom that we've converted into an art studio. So I have to kind of keep those fumes down. So painting with water-based medium is much safer on my lungs and I can work much quicker. But I will tell you, this is more difficult to work with than the oils. Oils are a more expensive medium, but like I said, they're so easy to blend and the colors are so rich and, you know, to get that depth and everything. Oils are wonderful, but this takes more of a process to get it to that point with all the layers that I have to do. So this actually takes me more work than painting in oils. But most people think that what I've painted is an oil painting when I'm done, because that's the way I want you to think. I want you to look at it and think it's an oil painting. So, but it's actually a lot more work to doing it this way. It's just quicker. Quicker drying time. Not quicker for me to do, because I can paint an oil painting quickly, but it doesn't dry. This takes me a lot longer to paint, but it dries quicker. So I'm already ready to go once it's finished. Anyway, that's just a little extra detail, extra information that you may or may not be interested in.
See, now I'm looking at this eye, and this dog has come to life for me. That may sound hokey, but I connect with every pet portrait that I do for that very reason. I'm staring into their eyes. They become my babies too. So when a person gets a pet portrait from me, I've bonded with their animal too. So besides pet portraits, as I stated earlier, I also do murals. I do quite large murals, and I'm used to scaffolding and, you know, can get up there. Well, I haven't done one in a while. I mean, it's been less than a year, but still, you know, murals are not something that you get that often unless you work for a sign company or something like that. But I still get phone calls about doing murals. So that's kind of exciting. I enjoy working large. The impact is, you know, on seeing something bigger than life is just, you know, makes a huge impact visually. I was privileged to do a mural for the South Carolina Aeronautical Training Center that's down at Trident Tech in North Charleston. That's partly owned by Boeing, and it has no animals in it. So it is a 15-foot by 19-foot mural. So if you haven't seen it and you're local to the area, it is open to the public. So you are welcome to go down there and check it out. Strangest mural I ever did was in Georgia. Went down, a family had hired me to paint both of their sons' bedrooms. And I had already done nursery murals for other family members of theirs. And so they asked me to come down and paint their sons' bedrooms. And the oldest son, I think he couldn't have been more than 12. When I got there, I knew it was going to be a hunting mural, but we hadn't quite decided because it was a distance. And so they paid for my travel and everything to go down. And so I hadn't seen the location in person. So I got down there and they brought out a head of a deer on a plaque that had been stuffed and mounted. It was his first buck that he had ever killed. And he wanted a hunting mural themed around the deer. And they asked me if I could incorporate that mounted head into his mural. So I did. He had a corner in his room, an outside corner that was in his room. So I painted the deer body that would fit the size of that head, and I asked him if they could take it off of the mounted plaque.
And they were able to do that. It had a hanging mechanism on it. So I painted the body on the outside corner and we hung the deer head, attached it to the body, and it was perfect. It was a 3D effect. It was really cool. And then I painted the surrounding with a tree and all sorts of other animals, birds and stuff like that. And I painted him a tree stand in this alcove area in the room. Anyway, it turned out really, really cool. And I guess now he's in college, so that was a while back. That was the oddest mural I think I've ever painted. After I painted it, I was on Pinterest and I got notified, and I wasn't the person who shared it, but anyway, it was shared all over Pinterest. So
it got popular.
So I think you can find it if you just type in deer mural or type in my name on Pinterest. You can find it. And I have it on YouTube and on my website too. It was quite unique. I'm going to move on from the eyes now and start working on the tongue. Or I just should say the mouth. I'm
This dog has like black spots inside of her mouth. And those are almost like birthmarks to me. So when I'm doing a pet portrait, let me use a smaller brush. When I'm doing a pet portrait, I always want to make sure that I get all those kind of details. You know, nobody's going to count the amount of hairs on their head, but they will notice if the spots are right or not. So if the dog has a distinguishing mark, like for instance, right along here, these spots, which I located prior to, there's a tiny little one right there that was I almost missed, and a tiny one right here, but also in the mouth. So when the tongue is showing, dogs can have little, you know, identifying birthmarks. Well, it's like we do as humans, freckles and things like that. I know my dog Augie, he's a mini golden doodle, and he has one of those chocolate noses, which I love because they're like pink underneath, but then chocolate brown around it. But he has a freckle on his nose that I think is so adorable. And if anybody else had ever painted his portrait, which incidentally I haven't painted his yet, he's only a little over a year, but if anyone else would have painted his portrait and they didn't capture that little freckle, I would be so disappointed. So I always make sure that I capture all those details. It's important. That's who that pet is. That's why having a really clear photograph helps. I know doing the portraits for that other company, they will sometimes send me a picture of a dog or a cat where one ear is cut off in the photo. And their only answer to me is, well, just put another one on the other side. And I'm like, well, if the other ear doesn't look like the other one, how am I gonna know? And that's not gonna be the same dog. I need to see the other ear, unless you just want me to leave it off completely. I would rather leave it off completely, like cut it out of the portrait, you know, like make it really large so you don't see that section, then add an ear that isn't that dog's ear. Accuracy to me is very important. I don't want to give a likeness. I want to capture that person's pet. It's a memory. It's a tribute. That's how important this is to me. So I'm not just gonna
give people just a, you know, unthought of painting. I want to get it right for you. And for those of you on here that have commissioned me before, that is my it's important to me, because I want you to feel emotionally connected to the painting, because otherwise, why have me do it?
putting the values into. So you can see the depth. Pick up some brown. So here's kind of an interesting story. Just to show you how people can be so crooked. Recently, I've been targeted by a lot of scammers who are specifically looking for artists to target. And it is just utterly ridiculous. Sometimes I play with them because I realize that they are trying to scam me. So I'll just kind of play along and see what they have to say. But they'll contact me. I literally get multiples a week with the same story. And it's always through Instagram. So I don't know what's going on. But they ask me, they'll just say, send me a message and say, commissions with a question mark. Every single one of them do the same thing. And I'm like, oh, here we go again. Because a normal person would say, you know, I'm looking for a portrait of my dog or my cat, or, you know, how much do you charge, or something like that. They'll ask me questions. But this, they start off with commissions. Just a question mark, the word commissions. So if I say yes, then they just start sending me this sob story about how that they will pay me whatever I want. And it's always an 11 by 14. I have no idea why. And it's not the same person every time. They'll pay me whatever I want. Now, most of them will say, I'll pay you $400 to do an 11 by 14. Well, first of all, it doesn't work like that. You don't tell me what you're going to pay me. You ask me and I will give you a quote. I don't know if they just think I'm desperate or something like that. But anyway, if you get into the conversation with them, it always turns out I'm doing this for my son, but I have to pay through his account, and it's his trust account, and so it's an electronic check, but it's good. I'll pay you ahead of time, and you do the portrait for me, and it's always broken English. Except for one from last week, which she kind of had me for a little while. Anyway, they want my account information so they can send me the money. So I won't do it, of course. So what I've been saying now is, please contact me through my website and I'll give them the link. And the woman from the other day, from last week, that I actually did think was legit, she was like, okay. So the next thing I know, she sends me a picture. Yeah, I should have been triggered by the fact that she wanted an 11 by 14. But anyway, I didn't catch that. And then I send her an invoice. We've discussed everything. And she actually did email me. But then when I sent her the link to pay me, which I accept all forms of payment. I accept through my website. I have a link. I accept all major credit cards. I accept bank transfers,
The only thing I don't generally accept is a check unless I know you and you're local. But she, after the whole process, and it went on for like a week, she's like, I can't pay using a third party. And I, okay, that makes no sense. So I emailed her and I said, how do you pay for your bills? How do you pay for groceries? Because unless you were local, and she wasn't, I said, there's no way. And then she quit responding. And I realized she was a scam. Because as soon as they say I can't do third party, then they send me this thing about I have to pay out of this checking account that's a, you know, electronic check. And all you have to do is send me your information and then you can cash it. And so once she got to that point, I knew she wasted my time. I have no idea why people would target artists. It's not exactly the most lucrative profession.
here. Well, I've been on here for an hour, so I think that I'm going to wrap it up on video for today. I'm going to continue painting. Again, I'm working on multiple paintings, so after I get part of this done, I'm going to put it away, and then I have these other paintings that I'm working on as well, and I'll be sharing and posting more so you can see the progress of them. But I'm going to let you go, and please share my video. This will be on a repeat, so you'll be able to do that. Share my video, share my contact information. I really appreciate that. It helps my audience to grow, and I appreciate all of you who came and joined me today. I hope it wasn't boring for you. I hope you did enjoy it. And I look forward to doing another Facebook Live video, and I'll post again, and perhaps I can do them on a regular basis, and I'll have more content to be able to discuss some things. But for right now, this was kind of my tryout to see how things would go. So I appreciate all of you who came and joined me, and enjoy the rest of your day. It's going to be in the 80s here in Charleston, so it's a beautiful day here. So my husband and I are supposed to go take a walk together on a little break, so I will catch up with you later. Thank you.